The Blackstone Anthology of Tales for a Stormy Night. This unabridged recording was produced in 2003 by Blackstone Audiobooks Incorporated, which holds the copyright thereto. Neither this recording nor any portion of it may be reproduced or used for any purpose without prior written authorization from Blackstone Audiobooks. And now, Tales for a Stormy Night. The Ghostly Rental by Henry James. Performed by Robertson Dean.
I was in my 22nd year, and I had just left college. I was at liberty to choose my career, and I chose it with much promptness. I afterwards renounced it, in truth, with equal ardor, but I have never regretted those 2 youthful years of perplexed and excited, but also of agreeable and fruitful experiment. I had a taste for theology, and during my college term I had been an admiring reader of Dr. Channing. This was theology of a grateful and succulent savor. It seemed to offer one the rose of faith, delightfully stripped of its thorns. And then, for I rather think this had something to do with it, I had taken a fancy to the old divinity school. I have always had an eye to the back scene in the human drama, and it seemed to me that I might play my part with a fair chance of applause, from myself at least, in that detached and tranquil home of mild casuistry. With its respectable avenue on one side, and its prospect of green fields and contact with acres of woodland on the other. Cambridge, for the lovers of woods and fields, has changed for the worse since those days, and the precinct in question has forfeited much of its mingled pastoral and scholastic quietude. It was then a college hall in the woods, a charming mixture. What it is now has nothing to do with my story. And I have no doubt that there are still doctrine-haunted young seniors who, as they stroll near it in the summer dusk, promise themselves later to taste of its fine, leisurely quality. For myself, I was not disappointed. I established myself in a great, square, low-browed room with deep window benches. Among my companions were 2 or 3 men of ability and of good fellowship, with whom I occasionally brewed a fireside bowl, and with adventurous reading, deep discourse, potations conscientiously shallow, and long country walks, my initiation into the clerical mystery progressed agreeably enough. With one of my comrades I formed an especial friendship, and we passed a great deal of time together. Unfortunately, he had a chronic weakness of one of his knees, which compelled him to lead a very sedentary life. And as I was a methodical pedestrian, this made some difference in our habits. I used often to stretch away from my daily ramble with no companion but the stick in my hand or the book in my pocket. But in the use of my legs and the sense of unstinted open air, I have always found company enough. I should perhaps add that in the enjoyment of a very sharp pair of eyes, I found something of a social pleasure. My eyes and I were on excellent terms. They were indefatigable observers of all wayside incidents, and so long as they were amused, I was contented. It is indeed owing to their inquisitive habits that I came into possession of this remarkable story. Much of the country about the old college town is pretty now, but it was prettier 30 years ago. That multitudinous eruption of domiciliary pasteboard which now graces the landscape in the direction of the low, blue Waltham hills had not yet taken place. There were no genteel cottages to put the shabby meadows and scrubby orchards to shame, a juxtaposition by which, in later years, neither element of the contrast is gained. Certain crooked crossroads then, as I remember them, were more deeply and naturally rural, and the solitary dwellings on the long grassy slopes beside them, under the tall, customary elm that curved its foliage in mid-air, like the outward dropping ears of a girdled wheat sheaf, sat with their shingled hoods well pulled down on their ears, and no prescience whatever of the fashion of French roofs, weather-wrinkled old peasant women, as you might call them, quietly wearing the native coif, and never...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.